There. Good as new. I don't think I thought this through properly.
Yo, so this video log and the next ones are gonna be a little dense because there's a lot of stuff to cover before we can even start making a game. So strap yourselves in. Hi, I'm adding this part here in post. So when I was writing the script for this episode, I was struggling not to use terms like bytes and hexadecimal because the N64 is a really low-level system. It's kind of important to understand what these terms mean. If you don't know what they are, I've made an extra video, which I've included in the video description, that should cover this stuff and teach you if you're unfamiliar with these subjects. Alright, that's all. Thanks. So before we can actually start making stuff for the N64, we need to know the system. And I don't mean that in like a candlelight dinner kind of way, though you're free to do that if you really want to. I mean, what's going on inside this plastic? Now, I could take my system apart and show you the hardware, but I spent a very long time making a presentation and I'm going to get my miles worth. Plus, I get to actually show it running off of the system. Alright, so when you take the console apart, you're gonna be left with this. This is the motherboard. It's essentially the nervous system of the console. It's what connects all the important parts to one another. We can ignore most of it, but the parts that are super important are the CPU, the RAM, and the RCP. The CPU, or the central processing unit, is the brain of the console. It's the part that reads the code and executes it. The RCP stands for Reality Coprocessor. It's a special chip that handles audio and graphics processing, as well as some other stuff. I won't be talking much about it today, but there's one important detail to highlight, and that is that it's a coprocessor. The CPU tells it what to do, and it crunches away at its job while the CPU does other stuff. Essentially, they work in parallel, but the CPU is its master. Finally, the random access memory, or RAM for short. This is the N64's long-term memory, and it stores everything. That can be code, images, sound, etc. Essentially, anytime the CPU or RCP needs something, it has to be in RAM first. The N64 has 4 megabytes of RAM, but it can be expanded to 8 megabytes if you have the expansion pack,
which is this red cart that you shove here in the front of the console, like that.
4 megabytes of memory is tiny, especially considering that you're probably watching this video on a device with 100 times that. Okay, so now that we got the boring part out of the way, we can actually try to get the custom code running. So as any programmer would know, once you complete the death trials and you pledge the Turing Oath, you're bound by the laws of the universe to primum salve mundi. This means that you have to print hello world at the start of every single programming project. This is a little hard to do on the N64. You see, as a programmer, all you're given is a kernel, which is a small bit of code that lets you manipulate parts of the hardware. The rest of the operating system has to be programmed by you. You can't just call like a bit of code that says, put this text on the screen. You have to program that bit of code. You have to program the screen. Hell, you need to program the font. All of this while worrying about where things are in memory and how much memory they take. Developers at the time had this like tall boy cartridge, which would let you send data over the wire to the computer using a parallel port. And this is supported by the N64 by default. Unfortunately, this hardware is incredibly rare and expensive. So we're gonna have to make do with a flash cart and with USB, which will work just as fine, if not better. This also has the added benefit of letting me upload ROMs to the N64 from my PC to speed up development. So all I have to do is write a bit of code which lets me send text from my console to my PC. And that's relatively easy to do with the 64 drive since it's incredibly well documented. There's a small problem, which is that the 64 drive is not the only flash cart in the market. The other ones that exist have completely different communication protocols. So if I have people collaborating on this project and they have, for instance, an EverDrive, that text code is not going to work for them.
Now, thankfully, I already did the suffering a year ago, and I wrote a library that supports the most popular flash cards in the market. Implementing that library into my starting project is relatively trivial. It's just adding in a few lines of code, and I can have my console saying hello to my PC. And of course, hitting reset restarts the program, so it's going to keep saying hello every time. Printing is very useful because it's one of the few ways that we can debug our programs. Having this set up as early as possible is a good idea. The code for this version is down in the video description if you want to check it out. Now, let's take this up a notch.
So in order to start outputting stuff to the TV, we're going to have to worry about two things. The first being the television standard, and the second being the frame buffer. Back when we had analog TVs, and they looked like this giant unwieldy box, there were three main television standards.
NTSC, used notably by Japan and most of America. CCAM, used by a few Asian and African countries, as well as France, for some reason. And PAL, used by everyone else except Brazil. Brazil uses a variant called PAL-M. There are no CCAM N64s. France instead has PAL N64s. So we can instead focus on these three formats. They actually have two important differences. The first difference is that NTSC runs at 60 Hz, meaning the image on the screen changes every 1/60th of a second, while PAL runs at 50. The second difference is that typically on the N64, NTSC games will run at a resolution of 320 by 240 pixels, or 640 by 480 if the game supports high definition mode. PAL, to compensate for its slower frame rate, has a slightly taller resolution of 320 by 288, or 640 by 576 in HD. The Brazilian PAL-M format has the frame rate of an NTSC system with the resolution of a PAL system. Since a lot of TVs don't support more than one of these signals, the N64 games are region-locked. This lets developers make versions of the game that make use of the fact that the TVs are different, like by rearranging parts of the game's interface. Many games don't do this though, instead they just either stretch the image, which makes it blurrier, or they just shove the NTSC screen into a PAL one and just call it a day.
This is a first party game, Nintendo! What are these black lines doing here? Come on!
Now luckily for me, this TV already supports the three standards, so I can at least have some space on my desk for my laptop. Okay, so remember how I said that the N64's memory stores everything? That also applies to what's going to be shown on the TV.
What this means is that in my code, I have to designate a section of my memory as what the TV will see. This block of memory is called a frame buffer, frame being the word for a single still image of video, and buffer being a computer science term for temporary storage. Now, as you probably know, both modern LED screens and CRT TV screens work because they have red, green, and blue lights that light up in different intensities to produce different shades of color. A single block of red, blue, and green is called a pixel. Now, there are many different ways to store individual pixels. The N64 supports both 16-bit and 32-bit. In 16-bit mode, each color is stored in 5 bits, with that last bit being unused. In 32-bit mode, each color is stored in 8 bits. This lets you express more colors of the rainbow at the expense of storage space. Regardless, there is no reason to use 32-bit mode on the N64. For one, you can barely tell the difference between 32-bit and 16-bit color, especially when the CRT decides to blur everything. And the second reason is that the N64 will always output 21-bit color. So in the end, that extra color data will be lost. Also, since the frame buffer would be bigger, it means that it's slower as the system needs to read and write more data for the same pixel. As a result, we want to define our block of memory for the frame buffer as being 320 multiplied by 240, or 288 if we're on PAL, multiplied by 2, because 16 bits means 2 bytes per pixel. As a result, our frame buffer will occupy 153,600 bytes of memory, or 184,320 bytes in PAL. Now, the position of the frame buffer in memory is important, but we're not going to worry about it too much right now. We can't place it in the first megabyte, since our code is, by default, placed there by the kernel when the system boots. For now, we'll just put it in the second megabyte of memory and add some code that tells the N64 to use that block of memory for our TV output.
Now, I can just fill that data with whatever I want and send it over to the TV. So as a basic test, I fill each byte of memory with a bunch of 0xFFs, and we should get a magnificent white screen. Brilliant. The code for this is also available down in the description. Now, this isn't a hello world, but since I can fill those pixels with whatever I want, I can just manually draw in a hello world.
Okay, so now that we've actually appeased the programming gods, we can start making a game... No, we can't. We still need to make an operating system. I'll see you next month.